Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome to my video. Okay, so I am going to do this video and give you guys some troubleshooting steps if you guys have the same issue that I had a couple days ago. I did get the problem fixed. Just want to tell you guys what I did to fix this issue, which was a crank but no start situation. All right, so basically, I was at Walmart and parked my car, went to Walmart, and spent about an hour there, came back out and tried to start my car, and my car cranked, but it did not start. It kept on cranking, but it did not start. So basically, best place to be if I had a situation, when I had that situation, considering, you know, if it's something easy to fix, I could probably get a lot of things. But anyway, I cranked it a couple of times. It kept on cranking. It kept on cranking. didn't start up. Didn't crank over. So first thing that came to my mind was it's probably the battery, right? Haven't changed the battery for a couple years. Probably the battery. I haven't actually touched the battery for a couple years. Haven't changed it. It was, you know, there's probably corrosion. But here's the thing about it. It was a strong crank. It wasn't a weak crank. It wasn't a slow crank. It was a strong crank. So that actually had me thinking, maybe it's not the battery. So I turned on the headlights, went out and checked the headlights. The headlights were pretty bright. So that actually made more of a case that it's probably not the battery. So I opened up the hood, obviously, checked out the battery. There was some corrosion on there. There was some corrosion on there. There was some corrosion on the battery. So basically what I did was I took some cans of Coke that I bought and put two cans and pretty much just dunked it on the terminals, pretty much just, you know, poured it on the terminals. It's kind of messy, it's kind of dirty, it's kind of messy, it's kind of dirty, it, you know, it's going to turn syrupy on you if you guys do that, but it will. Just take some water and rinse it off, guys. That's what I did also. But anyway, it oxidizes. It bubbled up. A lot of the corrosion was taken. Came off. And went back to Walmart to get a couple of things. Went back to Walmart to get a wire brush. And pretty much cleaned up the battery terminal. Terminals got a little set of wrenches and. But I probably didn't need to do all that because I actually have a power pack to test that out. Thinking about it right now. But anyway, I cleaned it up. Try to crank it. It cranked. I mean, the crank might have been a bit stronger, but it cranked. Just didn't turn over. So I was like, all right. Forgot that I had the power pack in the back. But took the power pack out, popped it on, and try to turn it over. It cranked. It did not turn over. So at that point, I was like, okay, probably, I'm like, at that point, I was 100% sure it wasn't the battery, considering the cranks were strong, it kept on cranking pretty strong, and putting the power pack on there, it should have just started up. It did not start up. So at that point, I was like, I can rule out it's not the battery. All right, as far as the wiring on the battery, I could rule out that it wasn't the wiring on the battery either, because I actually did check out the ground wire. The ground wire is a negative cable, guys. For the most part, the ground wire is just connected to the frame of the car. I looked at the ground wire just to see whether there was any kind of, whether it was loose, rusted, anything like that. It wasn't. It was very tight onto the frame, connected. There was no frayed wiring, anything like that. So I was like, okay. okay, it's not, probably not the wiring, probably not this. Okay, so I'm ruling out things at that point, all right? I'm ruling out the battery, I'm ruling out the wiring, and on top of that, I ruled out the alternator. The alternator wasn't really into, in you know, what I thought it was causing it anyway, considering, you know, it cranked up pretty strong. Cranking up pretty strong means that the battery was pretty strong. And when I put the cables on from the power pack, and it didn't start off up. It's not the alternator, guys. You guys think it's not the alternator? It's none of that other stuff. Okay. So at that point, I was like, here's the thing. As far as me, if you guys are in this situation, you guys trying to troubleshoot this whole entire thing, trying to rule out certain things. All right, here's the thing. There was no check engine light on the dash at all. No check engine light on the dash before the situation happened. I haven't had a check engine light on my dash for a while. Had some other issue, but that was a long time ago. No check engine light on the dash, okay? But I have an OBD2, and I plugged it in. And what you know, this situation could be caused by also your car's computer not registering, not connected to your car for whatever reason. Could be a fuse or short somewhere, whatever. But I had an OBD2, plugged it in just to make sure that there, you know, there's nothing that I can actually take from this situation as far as it's scanning the whole entire thing. It was able to scan the whole entire thing, scanned it, and then came back with analysis, you know, no codes, all the monitors were cleared, everything was good. At that point, I knew that it was able to read the car's computer. So there's nothing wrong with the car's PCM, ECM. There's nothing wrong with the computer at all that's causing it. On top of that, like I said, very important whether there's a check engine light or not check engine light when it comes to troubleshooting this issue. All right, no check engine light means that you could pretty much consider that, you know, all the other stuff that could be causing it with a sensor on there is probably not causing the issue. And when I say this, I mean the mass airflow sensor, I mean the throttle position sensor, I mean the camshaft sensor, I mean the crankshaft sensor, I mean every single thing that you could possibly think of, all those things that you could possibly think of that has a sensor to it that could be causing this issue, you could pretty much just rule every one of those things out, pretty much. Not always the case. Sometimes sensors go bad and the computer doesn't detect it, or it has a little bit of an issue and the computer doesn't detect it. But in this case, root all those things out. Camshaft, crankshaft, position sense, throttle position sense. Root every one of those things out. So at that point, all right, I'm down to pretty much a couple of things. I'm down to a couple of things. Fuses, relays, the fuel pump maybe. Okay, it could be a couple other things outside of that. But we're just gonna troubleshoot little by little. So I was troubleshooting it little by little. All right, so got to the fuses, got to the relays. And pretty much what I did was could not figure out whether a fuse was blown, did not actually smell any kind of burnt smell from it. So being as I was around at Walmart, went in and got a fuse tester, tested all the fuses. All the fuses were good. You know, all the fuses were good. There was not a single problem with the fuses. And I pretty much came to, it's either one of two things at that point that I could think of, all right? There could be a couple more things, you know, the ignition, etc. But I was down to a couple of things, and I looked at the relay, the fuel pump relay, all right? But before I did that, I was thinking it might be the fuel pump. So I was in my car, and I was trying to figure out whether I could hear hear the fuel pump whizzing, priming. All right, so if you guys don't know how to do this, essentially you would normally need two people to do this. One to listen to the fuel pump priming as the ignition is turned to the on position, not the crank position, because once you get to the crank position, you're gonna crank the car up and you're not gonna be able to hear it too well. All right, so basically it was just me there, so I was sitting in the car and I turned it onto the on position trying to hear whether there was a whizzing sound. All right, normally you would want somebody to turn on to the on position while somebody has the gas cap off and you're listening to hear whether there's a motor sound. I couldn't do that. So I was listening, trying to hear it, and got to, you know, I couldn't detect it at all. I could not detect it at all. You know, detect the sound at all. So at that point, I was like, oh, okay, all right, we're gonna just swap out some relays. So I looked at the fuel pump relay, and I noticed that there was another relay that was the same. I'm not sure exactly where that relay actually, you know, what component of the car that relay was for. Popped that relay out, popped it in, you know, popped the relays out of the fuel pump, popped that relay out, swapped it. Guess what? It cranked over. Easy fix. Because if it didn't crank over, I would have been sure that it was the fuel pump that was the problem, but it cranked over, guys. So pretty much at that point, I knew it was the relay that what needed to be swapped out. Drove it to an AutoZone, got the relay, and pretty much just swapped the right one back. And threw away the bad relay, popped in a new one, and haven't had any issues since, guys. So if you guys are in this situation and you guys are looking for some troubleshooting tips on stuff like that, okay, just pretty much do what I did as far as troubleshooting each of those components. Hopefully you don't have a weird situation where it's some pretty crappy situation where it's a computer issue and the computer's not connecting to your car, which comes up every once in a while, or maybe even a fuel pump issue where you need to swap out a fuel pump, which is a lot more expensive than a relay. But I hope this has helped you guys out. If you guys like this video, please leave a comment in the comment section. Please subscribe. Please give me a thumbs up. Thanks. All right, guys, take care.